Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to work through some nomenclature practice problems. If you're not comfortable with nomenclature, or you feel you could benefit from a review, pause this video and check out my in-depth naming tutorial video series along with the nomenclature practice quiz linked below or by going to leiaforsci.com/naming. Early in the semester, professors will start by drawing molecules with a lot of the atoms showing, as I have here. But the more advanced you get, the bigger the molecules, the more overwhelming. So I strongly urge you to check out the skeletal structure tutorial linked below and learn how to convert these molecules to line structure. In this case, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So let's redraw this as a simple 5-carbon chain where carbon 3 has a CH3 attached and an OH. I know this looks scary at first, but once you're comfortable with it, isn't it so much easier to see exactly what's going on with this line structure? I'm going to argue yes, so let's take the simple version and name it. Well, first we need to number it. And with the alcohol coming out of this carbon, but having the same number of carbons to the right and left, it doesn't matter if I choose to number this from the right side or the left side, because I'll get the same exact name. To name molecules like this, I'm going to use the puzzle piece approach that I teach in the tutorial link below, starting with 5 carbons in the parent for a first name of pent, only single bonds for a last name of ane. I have a 1-carbon substituent coming off of carbon 3, so I'll call this 3-methyl, where 3 tells me where it's located, meth tells me that it's only 1 carbon, and YL tells me that it's a substituent. The functional group on this molecule is an OH, or an alcohol, 3 tells me it's an alcohol, sitting on carbon 3. An OL for the suffix tells me that I have an alcohol functional group. Now that we have the pieces, let's put the name together, starting with a prefix of 3-methyl. Then we grab the first and last name for pentane, and finally add the suffix 3-ol. Some professors will accept this as your final answer, but in the case of a functional group where you have a number indicating where it is, you can drag that number out in front of the parent name to give us 3-methyl-3-pentane. And then, because we have a vowel following another vowel, we actually drop that E to add that OL for a final name of 3-methyl-3-pentanol. Both of these answers are correct. You're more likely to see this, but find out which your professor prefers to make sure you don't lose any points. Once again, we're given a molecule where all of the atoms are drawn out, and even though it still looks simple, I urge you to get into the habit of drawing this in line structure. Trust me, it'll save you a lot of confusion later. So what do we have? If I number this, not yet for the sake of naming, just for the sake of making sure I redraw the same number of carbons, I can even copy the shape and draw it exactly the same way. Carbons 1 and 2, go down for 3, up for 4, right for 5, down for 6, a double bond between 1 and 2, between 4 and 5, all the hydrogens disappeared, the molecule is so much simpler, and now we're ready to name. We numbered it here just to see what's going on, but now we want to verify. This molecule is not symmetrical, so it does matter where we start. And in the case of having 2 double bonds, we want to start with the total lowest set of numbers, which means if I put a carbon 1 on the left, I hit the pi bond at carbon 1, but if I started from the right, I would hit the pi bond at carbon number 2, which means I have to stick to the left. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I have 6 carbons in my parent chain, giving me a first name of hex. I have 2 double bonds, which would give me a last name of ene, but I have to specify. I have a double bond between carbons 1 and 2, but it starts at 1. I have another double bond between 4 and 5, but it starts at 4, which means I put 1 for the first pi bond, comma, 4 for the second pi bond, dash, di to tell me that I have 2, and ene for the pi bonds. Again, we have ene for the pi bonds, di because I have to specify 2, and then 1 and 4 tells me where the pi bonds begin on the molecule. And that's it. I don't have any functional groups or any substituents, so I'm ready to put the name together. Just like with the alcohol, we can take these two numbers and drag them out to the front, which gives me 1, 4. But unlike the alcohol, where we had a vowel following a vowel, here we have a consonant followed by a consonant, which means we want to add a vowel in. And that gives me 1, 4-hexadiene. Hexadiene doesn't read well, so you add that A, giving us 1,4-hexadiene. If you haven't been following the puzzle piece approach up to now, I strongly recommend you use it for this molecule. And if you don't know that approach, pause this video, go watch my naming videos, and come back and see if this becomes a little easier. The first thing we want to do is identify our parent chain, which is not only the longest carbon chain, but also, because we have a carboxylic acid, it has to include the carboxylic acid. So let's start here, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4. Now at this junction, you might be wondering, do I go this way or do I go that way? And the way to figure that out is by the junction rule, which I also teach in the naming series. And that is simply counting to see which one has more. 1, 2, 3 as the longest, or 1, 2, 3, 4. The longest wins, and I keep going to the left. 5, 6, 7, 8. Now we know we have 8 carbons in the parent chain, but let's number it just to verify. The carboxylic acid is an automatic number 1 because it's the highest priority functional group. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I have 8 carbons in my parent chain, giving me a first name of oct. I have only single bonds, giving me a last name of ane. And I've already identified my functional group as a carboxylic acid, which gives me a suffix of oic acid, 2 separate words. I'm not going to include a 1 for the position of the carboxylic acid, because as the highest priority functional group, it is automatically understood to be on the first carbon, meaning it cannot be on something that isn't the first carbon. Unless you have 2 carboxylic acids, in this case, 1 is on the first and 1 is on the last. But I didn't make it that crazy here. We have our functional group. Let's identify all the substituents. I like to mark them off as I name them to make sure I didn't miss anything. On carbon 3, I have an OH, which is an alcohol functional group, except that in the presence of a carboxylic acid, where the carboxyl is higher priority, the oxygen is not the highest priority functional group, and that means it does not get named with a suffix. Instead, I like to think of it as getting demoted to a substituent, which would give me a hydroxy group on carbon 3, where hydroxy tells us alcohol as a substituent rather than alcohol as a functional group. On carbon 4, I have a 4-carbon substituent, but they're not 4 carbons in a row, so it's not just a butyl group. Instead, it's got that iso tail at the end, reminding me that this is an isobutyl group, an isomer of butyl, specifically with that bent tail at the end. On carbon 5, I have a chlorine, which gives me 5-chloro. On carbons 6 and 7, I have the same group, which is a methyl group. That means I have to include the number 6 and the number 7 to tell me where they show up, dash, di to tell me that I have 2, and methyl for the group. So the substituents on 6 and 7 are 6,7-dimethyl. And this is why I color it up. Notice that every single group has been circled and therefore accounted for. That means nothing's going to be left out, so I want to put the name together. I need to start with my substituents, but I first have to put them in alphabetical order. So let's see what we have to compare. I have an H for 3-hydroxy. I have an I for isobutyl. I have a C for chloro, and I have an M for dimethyl. This is a trick. Anytime you have more than 1, and you have to name it di, tri, tetra, those don't count, only the M. But iso is an exception to that rule, where you do count the I for iso. Taking this into consideration, we'll start with the C for chloro, then the H for hydroxy, I for iso, and M for methyl. That gives me 5-chloro-3-hydroxy-4-isobutyl-6,7-dimethyl. And we're running out of space, but we still have some name to go. So let's squish it together. And then, just like with the alcohol, if we have ane ending with a vowel and oic acid starting with a vowel, we drop that e to give us octanoic acid, where acid is a separate word. So our final name is 5-chloro-3-hydroxy-4-isobutyl-6,7-dimethyl-octanoic acid. Phew, that's a mouthful. If you followed up to here and you want even more practice, or if you first want to review the naming series, including the puzzle piece approach and everything I showed you here, first, make sure to give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and hit that bell icon so you don't miss out on any new videos. Then, catch the entire series along with the naming practice quiz and cheat sheet on my website, layerforsci.com/naming. Again, that's layerforsci.com/naming.